I was 14, I thought I was 18, but whatever. Okay, so what we're going to do here is I'm going to read a story. These poor people behind me have never heard this story. They have really no idea what it's about. But in true jamming fashion, hopefully they're going to sort of play with and underneath the story. This story is it's a true story, primarily. I sort of bend time and space a little bit, and and other things. Guess I don't need to go there. But so this one here is based on a story that I wrote from a ride that I went on with my father years ago. And the whole thing with this trip is it sort of, we weren't going very far, just up over the ridge and that. But with some of the things that we've seen, it sort of really sort of clarified how things can change, and when you think you're seeing one thing, you're thinking you're actually seeing something completely different. And so whatever, I'll start. I promised you wasn't going to wreck this in the back, but we'll see. Sorry.
So,
is that better? Okay. So this is from Long Live Johnny and Other Tales to Live By, alternatively titled, I won't go there. Okay, back to the nest, or the sense that God gave geese. Stuck out in the country, things are, let's say, more than a little less hectic compared to living in the city. Frankly, we have a hard time understanding how you can do it. I guess you could argue that country life could be a little on the boring side. Where are the theaters, the concerts, the museums, the people for that matter? On the other hand, I wonder the city. Where are the fishing holes, the forests, the trees? I guess no matter who you are, you need to see a certain mix to be happy and free. We see that in our kids, no matter where we're from. They're growing up so different. It's hard to imagine. Just what do they need to see? Not so for geese, all migratory creatures for that matter. Just traveling back and forth, looking for that perfect seasonal mix that they need. A happy, free mix that's also good for you and me. Now if you watch a nature channel, or listen to your average ornithologist, you would get the impression that these migratory routes are unchanging, static, back to the nest kind of thing, consistent throughout the ages. Well, I can tell you without a doubt that this isn't the case. When you settle to a place away from a lot of distractions, let's say a place like Lac de Bonnet, you start to see things in cycles and seasons that create certain patterns. At first you think the patterns are fixed, unchanging. With time, though, you come to realize that they subtly and sometimes dramatically change, over time distorting the pattern until you're left with something that doesn't even remotely resemble what you started with. It makes you wonder if this has always been the case. Take a look at our town here. It's just 100 years old, barely a blip in time. For most of this time, it's been a magnet for newcomers, a place where people wanted to be, all of us, including the geese, making our livelihoods from the earth, the river, and trees, a place where we imagine our kids would want to be. It's funny though, times change, styles change, generations pass. Kids go off to school, ditches are dug, bogs drained and crops planted, then rotated, then changed. What was once a patchwork of bogs and forests, slowly evolving into a quiltwork of fields, waterfront slowly being pockmarked with cottages, each a dream of a better kind of place, but ugly when taken as a whole. I'm really starting to understand what the now almost extinct natives feel. Hey, this was our land. You know, one day I was given a glimpse of where this slow, steady change might take us. I was with my dad. He was driving. We were talking about the old days, heading west, facing the late afternoon sun. It was brutally hot. We've been at dry spell for a while. We were talking about the potential Lac de Bonnet had when we first moved here. Way off in the distance, we could see this giant plume of smoke. It went on as far as you could see to the south, and almost touched the horizon to the north. Yep, Lac de Bonnet was the place to be. It must be one hell of a fire. No surprise, though, it's been some kind of a drought. It was a great place to grow a business, raise a family. It looked like it had a solid future. A few mines, a paper mill, tons of tourists. a major research facility, and a nature lover's paradise to boot. You couldn't ask for more. We're clipping along pretty good, and that smoke doesn't seem to be getting any closer. I'm starting to wonder what was coming. Talk slowly moves to how things are changing. Government cutbacks resulting in the wayside campgrounds being closed. No biggie. There's lots of other jobs in the area. The smoke doesn't seem to be any closer. Just recently a couple of mines closed down. No worries. We have cottagers moving in. Man, I wish we had air conditioning. Did I tell you? They just announced a hiring freeze at the plant. Talk of layoffs to come. No biggie. There's lots of work fighting fires. We're still driving the evening sun. It must have been a Friday. As we were driving against the eastern migratory flow of the weekend cottager, man, that fire must be bigger than we thought. We've been touring down this highway for 15 minutes, and we're still not under the smoke. My pop mentions that I should keep an eye out for deer as opposed to watching the gloom. The last thing we need was to smack one of those. Funny, it just occurred to me. It used to be moose that we had to dodge when we first moved out here. That's just no longer the case. I can't remember the last time I seen a moose. This goes for elk, mule deer, and caribou as well. I've been told that they've been driven out by the white-tailed deer. I guess white-tailed are new to the area. They follow people, farmers that is, need them to break the land, drain the bogs, and make the fields so that they can survive. I heard there used to be white bear around here as well. I guess we were treasured by the fur traders. Didn't take long, and they were all gone as well. So I'm wandering off, thinking, I'm one of four kids, the only one to stay in the area. Wondering how long my job will last. Wondering how my kids will make a living out here if we don't make a few changes. It shouldn't be hard. Everyone new to the area seems to think we have a diamond in the rough. All we have to do is change a few small things. Replace a few missing pieces. Create a few more opportunities. Modify a few cycles. Change a few patterns of behavior. And we have it made. So I look up, hoping that me ignoring the deer won't humble me in the long run, only be truly humbled. Holy crap, that was no fire. What we thought was a plume of smoke slowly evolved, distorted, and revealed itself to be an exodus of geese. Heading west, opposite the migratory flow of the cottagers, literally tens of thousands of flocks, millions of geese, midsummer, all coming to the realization that this area couldn't support them anymore. As one, rising and heading to the promise of the west, leaving a place for the earth, the forests, the rivers, and the trees, a place, if they could only, they'd still rather be. It must have taken 5 minutes to cross the plume of geese. Hell, it would have taken hours to drive the length. Suddenly it's all clear. Times change. So do circumstances. Damn it, there's a deer. Close call. If it was a moose, we would have hit it. A funny thing. I guess it's not actually the white-tailed deer that has forced out the moose. It's actually a brain-wasting disease they carry with them. I guess the white-tail can happily tool around, their brain slowly being eaten, not really processing what's happening around them. Just acting happy and a little too. Meanwhile, the moose, mule deer, elk, and caribou all die. They all die out infected. The only way for them to survive is for them to recede farther into their unadulterated habitat, farther from the white-tailed deer, farther from people. I kind of wonder if people have the same problem as white-tailed deer. We seemingly, obtusely, go about our business, vaguely aware of the damage we're causing, but yet, not having the presence of mind to change, or to even really care about the future. Convinced that doing what we always did got us this far, and what was good enough for us, obviously be more than good enough for our kids. Numbly mistaking an exodus of our youth for a plume of smoke. Not seeing that our kids are migrating away from what we created, believed in, and valued. Not realizing that with a few small changes, the kids wouldn't have to leave in the first place. So where does it leave us? I guess it looks like we're all migratory beasts, and that maybe in the end, we gave our children something that it seems obvious that we've forgotten we had. What's that? Well, the sense that God gave peace. So back to the ornithologist, the Nature Channel. A couple weeks after seeing this mass exodus, I heard an ornithologist interviewed on the radio. He was going on about the massive collapse in the native geese population. It was a mystery. They couldn't find any bodies and were asking the assistance of the general public. If you found a dead goose, please let them know. They need to do some in-depth studies. Find out if they starved from the drought, or was it some kind of insidious disease? Either way, it was going to take decades for the population to recover. They wanted us to know that they needed some additional funding. I was a little floored, to say the least. You study birds, but yet you didn't bother to look up. Maybe they were all indoors at a conference. Who knows? As for the geese, the very next year they were back. A miraculous recovery, if you're a listen to ornithologists. The end of the drought, if you were to ask me. There were a few less geese, that's true. But I guess the drought was over, and they wanted back. Sure, a few of them found greener pastures when they were away. But for the most part, they returned. They weren't really interested in leaving a place where the earth, the forests, the rivers, and the trees was a place they would rather be. Thank you very, very much. That was Rush. And you are going to be rushed out by Sol James here, so take her away.